All right, Navigators, welcome to Sunday Morning Chapel. We're going to sing a couple songs before we get into our lesson. Stand up nice, tall, and straight. Sing out, Jesus loves the little children. Get ready and sing.
Jesus loves the little children, all the children of the world. Red and yellow, black and white, they are precious in His sight. Jesus loves the little children of the world. Jesus loves the little children, all the children of the world. Red and yellow, black and white, they are precious in His sight. Jesus loves the little children of the world.
All right, now, oh, be careful. Oh, be careful.
Careful little ears, what you hear. Oh, be careful little ears, what you hear. For the Father up above is looking down in love. Oh, be careful little ears, what you hear. Oh, be careful little eyes, what you see. Oh, be careful little eyes, what you see. For the Father up above is looking down in love. Oh, be careful, little eyes, what you see. Oh, be careful, little hands, what you do. Oh, be careful, little hands, what you do. For the Father up above is looking down in love. Oh, be careful, little hands, what you do. Oh, be careful, little feet, where you go. Oh, be careful, little feet, where you go. For the Father up above is looking down in love. Oh, be careful, little feet, where you go.
All right, get singing. Get your Bibles out. Ready for the lesson. All right, take your Bibles to John chapter 12, the Gospel of John chapter 12. Our next lesson on the parables from the Gospel of John. And the title of this parable is Dying to Grow. Dying to grow. In John chapter 12, verse 20 through 22, says, "And there were certain Greeks among them that came up to worship at the feast. The same came therefore to Philip, which was of Bethsaida of Galilee, and desired him, saying, Sir, we would see Jesus. Philip cometh and telleth Andrew, and again Andrew and Philip tell Jesus." So these Greeks, these are Gentiles. These are Gentiles that have converted to the law of Moses, to the Hebrew faith. They have denounced their pagan religion and the worship of their homeland, and they have taken up the law of Moses as their faith. And this feast that they're coming to is the feast of the Passover. In the setting that we're in, Jesus has raised his friend Lazarus from the dead. Mary has anointed his feet with the ointment. And he's entered Jerusalem in his triumphal entry, where he rides on the colt of the donkey. And they put their palm branches and their garments in the streets, and they cry, Hosanna, the King of Israel. And Jesus' parable here tells and foretells of the correct time and what will happen in the very near future. Verse number 23. And Jesus answered Philip and Andrew. Jesus answered them, saying, The hour is come that the Son of Man should be glorified. The hour is come that the Son of Man should be glorified. Now the hour is come. This is the time. This is the proper place. It's going to happen. The one that was planned for through the ages. The one that Jesus, was born for, the one that he has lived for and ministered and worked toward the last 3.5 years, and the hour that he will die for. And the hour has come. So the Gentiles, the Hebrews and the Gentiles come. They want to see Jesus. They want to seek Jesus. They want to speak to Jesus. And the hour has come. It's fulfilled. It's confirmed in the mind of Christ. It's his time. This is the hour. It's going to happen. And he's going to start working and preparing himself and his disciples for that final stage before the crucifixion. And he gives this parable. He says, the hour has come that the Son of Man should be glorified. Verse number 24. Verily, verily, I say unto you, except the corn of wheat fall into the ground and die, it abideth alone. But if it die, it bringeth forth much fruit. This corn or this grain must fall to the ground. It cannot grow and it cannot be planted if it's not in the ground. It must be cast, it must be sown, and if it keeps to itself and it keeps alive, it won't bring forth much fruit. But if it die, if it goes to the earth, and if it dies, it'll bring much more than just a single thing. It'll bring forth much fruit. Here, Jesus is not concerned about living, but he knows the time, the hour has come for him to die, and he must die to pay the price to bring forth much fruit, many souls, into the kingdom that is to come, and the kingdom that he will one day rule and reign over. We're working our way to the cross, and Jesus knows he must die. But when he dies, and when that seed, and when he talks about it, the planting of the seed, where a seed is cast or sown, it goes into the earth. And if it dies, it remains but a short time. And then it starts to come, it starts to rise. And it brings forth much, much fruit. In verse number 25, Jesus tells us, he that loveth his life shall lose it. And he that hath his life, that hateth his life in this world, shall keep it unto life eternal. Anyone who loves his life or is unwilling to give up his life will lose it anyway. They will abide alone. They will never mature. They will never bring forth much fruit. But he that hates or is willing to sacrifice or give up his life in and of the present life and the present world that we live in will lose it, but retain and keep it throughout eternity, life eternal. He that hateth his life in this world shall keep it unto life eternal. Jesus was willing to go and pay the ultimate sacrifice. He knew that he must go to the cross. He knew he must die. He knew he must be planted in the earth. But a short while later, he rose again. And he tells us here that if we love our life and we love this world and we'd rather spend time in it more than time with him, he hateth that loveth his life will lose it. It's lost. You'll never have it. You'll never keep it. It'll never last. But he that hateth his life in this world shall keep it unto life eternal. If you love something more than this present life and this present world, it's in a good place and in good hands, and it will be there for a very long time. So as we look and we're moving through the parables, we come here, Jesus is foretelling of himself. He speaks of himself as that grain. It must fall. It must fall to the earth. It must die. But when it rises again, it'll bring forth much fruit. And without argument or debate in any matter of this world, no one can doubt that the resurrected Christ has brought forth much fruit and continues to bring forth much fruit. And that is our job, and our goal is to go out and continue to share and to grow and to bring fruit and to collect the grain and put it to the storehouse for the kingdom for when Christ is ready to come and he'll take over and he'll rule and reign. So let's be present there in that eternity. Let's have that eternal life, and let's spend a little less time concerning ourselves about this earthly life and the temporary things, and let's think more of on eternal things and that life that we will have if we just let go of this one and we plan more for the next one.